every few months or so, our computers become smaller. There you have the Amiga 2000 released by Commodore in 1987, and there you have the modern day iMac. When you first look at these two computers, you notice one thing in particular. The iMac is a lot thinner than the Amiga 2000. This makes it look nicer and also makes it more portable. But we also know that the iMac is a lot faster than the Amiga 2000. So how did we go from this to this in just 3 decades? Well, the answer lies in transistors. Our computers consist of computer chips, which consist of modules, which are made out of logic gates, which can be made from transistors. And these transistors are the fundamental components of our computers. Transistors are made out of semiconductors, like silicon, and they can turn on or off to block or let through the flow of information. And this information is carried through electricity, which is defined as the movement of electrons. And over the past few decades, scientists have been shrinking our transistors to make our computers smaller. In fact, Gordon Moore observed that for every 1 or 2 years, our transistor shrinks to half their size. He called this Moore's Law. Moore's Law is important to the development of technology because when you reduce the size of a transistor, you reduce the distance the electron needs to travel. So this makes the computer operate faster. There's an important parallel to Moore's Law called Dinard scaling, which says that the current and voltage necessary to power a transistor scales at the same rate the size of the transistor decreases. So this is based on Ohm's Law. When you reduce the size of the transistor, less heat is dissipated because the electron experiences less resistance. This makes the transistor cooler. And for a long time, Dinard scaling held to be true. But it's sort of like putting hard work into something and expecting and getting exactly what you expect in return. It was too good to be true. In the mid-2000s, when transistors reached around 90 nanometers, scientists started noticing electrical current leakages. Electrical current leakages are sort of like water pipe leakages. When your water pipe is really thin, it's not that sturdy, so holes are more likely to form and water is more likely to leak out. Similarly, electrical current leakages are when the electrical current moves out of the intended path inside a transistor, and it flows into the insulating region of the semiconductor device. And this causes the machine to overheat and fail. As a result of this, cooling elements like fans needed to be instilled into computers. This made the computers more expensive. And on top of that, Moore's Law was also reaching its limits. Our transistors are reaching quantum scale. Today, a transistor is around 7 to 14 nanometers. That's 500 times smaller than a red blood cell. And as we approach this quantum realm, our traditional physics stops working. And on top of that, the wavelength of electricity in silicon, which is what makes up a transistor, is 5 nanometers long. So if you have a transistor that's 5 nanometers wide, your electron will be in both places at the same time, and your transistor will never be off. So does this mean that we've reached a ceiling in our technological development? There are many articles out there saying that we've reached the gadget apocalypse. They also say that in the next few years, the development of technology will start to plateau. But as we've seen over the past few decades, we've made paradigm shifts throughout history, coming up with new ideas and new inventions. There are many more things to be created, like artificial intelligence, genetically designed life forms, and artificial organs. But today I'm going to be focusing on how we will replace electricity, how we will move past these barriers presented to us by the breakdown of Bernard Scaling and the breakdown of Moore's Law. To begin with, let's first reject electricity as immediate information completely. What's the fastest thing we know of? Light. Light moves at 10 to the 8 meters per second, depending on the medium, of course. Well, that's still incredibly fast. Imagine if all our devices were powered by light. This field that intersects light and electricity has been around for decades, and it's called photonics or optoelectronics. We no longer need satellites as much to make calls or surf the web. Instead, we use optic fiber to help us communicate with each other. And scientists have also made many other optic devices. This is because optic devices have a lot more benefits than electrical ones. To begin with, an optical power transistor can be designed to operate in parallel. What does this mean? Well, many of our modern day supercomputers that operate really quickly still operate in serial mode. This means they perform one calculation at a time. But if we design our optical transistors to operate in parallel mode, they can perform multiple calculations at a single time. In fact, a company called Optalysis in the United Kingdom is working on a transistor that operates in parallel mode. And what they do is they shine low-level laser beams through this crystal grid, as shown in this picture. And this numerical data is then entered by applying varying voltages through the crystal grid to change the optical density of each laser beam. And by modulating these light waves, we can encode analog in them. So when they leave the crystal grid, they do refract and form an interference pattern, allowing the computer calculation to be finished. This is a picture of Optalysis prototype of their computer. And soon they plan to release an exascale computer by the year 2020. But that's not to say that these light power devices are the panacea to all of our technological problems. This field still presents a lot of issues. For instance, in the atomic world, light is actually really big. But scientists have been looking for ways to move past these issues. And these challenges are inevitable in the development of technology. So as I mentioned before, by the year 2020, Optalysis plans to release their exascale computer. And last year, they already released their third generation prototype. What I mean by exascale is that it performs a billion calculations per second. That's incredibly fast. Not only will these light power computers be more fast and efficient than electrical ones, but they'll also mark a new milestone in our development of technology. Thank you.